Hi guys, welcome to Techie DIY. In this video, I'm going to make some improvements to the LED mirror that I made in a previous video. Firstly, I'm going to replace the image on the mirror with a 3D skull design. Next, I will install a rechargeable battery to make the mirror portable. And finally, I'll replace the LED controller with an Arduino microcontroller to program custom lighting sequences. The battery I'm going to use is an 18650 lithium cell, and that will be charged and protected by a TP4056 module. The microcontroller is an Arduino Pro Mini clone, and I'll use the Fast LED library to program the WS2812B LED strip. One of the problems associated with using color RGB lights in an edge lit display is that the colors mix in the glass and form a different color. For example, if the LEDs in a strip are set to a sequence of red, green, and blue, then the display will show white. If the colour groups are larger, then the effect is diminished. And by careful selection of colours, some very good effects can be achieved. This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, where you can order high-quality custom-printed circuit boards for extremely low prices, currently as low as $2 for 10 double-sided PCBs with free shipping on your first order. Design the PCB using your favourite software and upload the Gerber files to the JLC PCB website. Review the design using the Gerber viewer and then securely check out to receive the free shipping offer. You can check the order status online at any time. The quality of the PCBs is excellent, and at this price, it's a great way of turning your designs into quality products. This is the wiring diagram for the rechargeable battery circuit. The battery holder is the type with metal tabs rather than springs, as I find them more reliable. The positive side of the battery holder is connected to an inline fuse holder, and the other side of the fuse holder is connected to the positive battery input of the TP4056 module. The positive output from the TP4056 is connected to a 3-amp SPDT switch, and to overcome the problem of not having any mounting holes on the TP4056 module, I've added a micro USB breakout board. The first task is to solder the inline fuse holder into the positive side of a length of DC cable, making sure to install the body of the fuse and the spring before soldering on the contact. Then the offcut of wire can be soldered to the second contact. The fuse is then assembled. I've used a 3-amp fast blow fuse, and its function is to protect the battery in the event of a short circuit. Then the DC cable is soldered to the battery holder. And the other end of the DC cable is soldered to the battery input of the TP4056 module, making sure that the polarity is correct, or you might see a puff of magic smoke. A second length of DC cable is soldered to the output of the TP4056 module. The switch is soldered into the positive side of the cable. The connections are insulated with heat shrink tubing. And this is a good point to check that everything is working and we have power on the output wires. To terminate the connections, WAGO terminal blocks are installed. Two lengths of wire are then cut and soldered between the input power solder pads on the TP4056 module and the corresponding pads on the micro USB breakout board. To mount the switch, I'm using a cheap metal bracket that was designed for fencing. I've enlarged one of the holes so that the switch fits through, and the bracket is going to be installed on the side of the case so that the switch lever just pokes through a hole in the back. I'm doing it this way because I don't know at this stage where I ultimately want to position the switch, and the plywood back panel is sacrificial and easily replaceable. The bracket is screwed into position, and then the plywood back is marked and a clearance hole drilled for the switch lever. The USB breakout board is screwed into the side where I had already cut out a section of the plywood back for the power cable. The positions of the connection pins on the battery holder are marked and a couple of holes drilled for clearance. battery holder is then screwed into position. I decided to replace the image on the mirror with a 3D skull design. The skull image is taped to the back of a new mirror tile, it's stuck down with water-soluble glue, and then I used a Dremel engraver to trace the lines on the image. For the full process, please watch the first video, which has more detail. I did make a mistake this time and forgot to remove the white plastic backing from the mirror tile, which meant that it took ages removing all of the individual pieces, and it did also remove a bit of the paint as well. Nonetheless, the front looked good, so it was installed in the frame, followed by a plywood back, and these were held in place with glazier points. The battery is charged by plugging a 5-volt power supply into the micro USB connector. The LED glows red while it's charging and blue when it's fully charged. On this module, the charger function is provided by a TC4056A integrated circuit, which according to the datasheet is a complete constant current stroke constant voltage linear charger for single cell lithium ion batteries. The maximum charging current is set by a resistor connected between pin 2, prog and ground. On this module it's R3 and its value is 1.2 kiloohms. Using the formula from the datasheet, this gives a maximum charge current of 1 amp. The battery protection circuit is provided by a DW01K, which is a 1 cell lithium battery protection integrated circuit, along with an 8205A, which is a dual N-channel MOSFET. This prevents the cell from being charged above 4.3 volts and discharged below 2.4 volts. So the output voltage from the battery circuit is between 3 volts when the battery is discharged and 4.2 volts when it's fully charged. All of the WS2812B LED strips that I've tried work okay within this voltage range. So let's install the controller that used in the first video and see if it works, which it does. The next part of the project is to replace the LED controller with an Arduino. The board that I'm using is a Pro Mini clone, which is based around the ATmega 328P, the same microcontroller used in the Arduino Uno. It is available in 3.3 volt or 5 volt versions. The 3.3 volt version has an 8 MHz clock speed, and the 5 volt version has a 16 MHz clock speed. The ATmega 328P on the Pro Mini can operate from 1.8 volts to 5.5 volts. But the actual supply voltage required depends on the clock speed. For a supply voltage of 4.2 volts, the maximum clock speed is 18 MHz, and for a 3 volt supply, the maximum clock speed is 12 MHz. Because we have a battery power supply with a voltage output of 3 volts to 4.2 volts, we can power the microcontroller directly without using the voltage regulator on the Pro Mini board. To do that, the positive side of the power supply is connected to the VCC pin on the Pro Mini and the negative side to ground. And because the maximum clock speed at 3 volts is 12 MHz, we should use a 3.3 volt 8 MHz Pro Mini. However, in practice, I found that the 5 volt 16 MHz Pro Mini also works okay, just don't use this combination for anything mission critical. The LED strip consists of a series of WS2812B LEDs. These are intelligent RGB LEDs with a built-in control circuit. The connections on the LEDs are VDD, which is the positive power input, Dout, which is the controlled data output, VSS, which is the ground, and Din, which is the controlled data input. The power supply voltage range is 3.5 volts to 5.3 volts, but in practice they usually work on 3 volts. The LEDs are connected in series with the Dout of one LED connected to the Din of the next. The first and last LEDs on a strip are terminated in female and male connectors respectively, and these connectors can be used to extend the LED strip by chaining strips together. To control the LED strip with an Arduino, then the D-in of the first LED is connected to an output port on the Arduino. We can either solder directly to the LED strip, use the connector from the output side of the LED strip, or use the spare connector that is often supplied. For this project, I'm using a spare male connector and its pins are color-coded like this. These seem to be fairly standard, but it's a good idea to trace the wires back and check. This is the circuit diagram. The LED strip and the Pro Mini are connected to the battery power supply by separate wires. The LED strip and Pro Mini are connected together by a ground wire, and another wire connects the D-in on the LED strip via a 220 ohm resistor to digital pin 4 on the Pro Mini. The 220 ohm resistor is commonly included to reduce noise, And for longer LED strips, an electrolytic capacitor is recommended to be connected across the LED strip power input pins. So let's start off by soldering the wires to the Pro Mini with a black wire to the first ground pad and a red wire to the VCC pad. The wire that I'm using is flexible hookup wire with 7 0.2mm strands. Then a green wire is soldered to digital pin 4 or D4 and another black wire to the second ground pad. Then moving on to the LED connector, a 220 ohm resistor is soldered onto the green D-in wire. The white ground wire from the LED connector is soldered to a ground wire from the Pro Mini and also to the negative side of a length of 3 amp DC cable. The green wire from the Pro Mini is soldered to the other side of the resistor, and then the red wire from the LED connector is soldered to the red positive side of the DC cable. Finally, heat shrink tubing was installed over the connections. To program the Pro Mini, the Arduino IDE software is used. I'll put a link to a video on how to install that in the description. The Pro Mini doesn't have an onboard USB port like the Arduino Uno, so to program it, an FTDI 232 USB to serial adapter is used. This is plugged into a USB port on the computer, and the adapter pins are connected to the Pro Mini. There are 6 pins and a jumper to select 3.3 volts or 5 volts. 3.3 volts should be selected for an 8 MHz board, and 5 volts for a 16 MHz board. And when we're ready for programming, the adapter pins are pushed into the solder pads on the Pro Mini, making sure that they're correctly oriented, and the VCC pin on the adapter should connect to the VCC pin on the Pro Mini. Next, the Arduino IDE software is loaded. Configure the board type by selecting Tools from the menu, select Board, and then Arduino Pro or Pro Mini. And then select Tools again, Port to check the COM port selected, and Processor, where we can select the type of processor, its voltage and speed. In this case, I'm using an 8 MHz 3.3 volt Pro Mini. To program the WS2812B LED strip, I'm going to use the Fast LED library, select Sketch from the menu, Include Library, Manage Libraries, and then enter Fast LED in the search, and install. Alternatively, the library can be downloaded in zip format from GitHub and installed. Again, I'll put a link to it in the description. So that's the Fast LED library installed. It includes quite a few examples, so let's try one called Color Palette. First of all, we need to change the LED pin to 4, the number of LEDs to 18, the LED type to WS2812B, and the color order is correct for the LED strip that I'm using. So let's compile and upload that. Next, the Pro Mini was plugged into the LED connector. The 2 sets of power wires were connected to the WAGO connectors, and the Pro Mini was temporarily secured to the case with a Velcro pad. And this is the result. Unfortunately, it doesn't show up on camera, but to the naked eye, the skull looks like it's moving. It's quite a weird effect. I've no idea why this is, so if you've any idea, please let me know in the comments. Let's have a look at a simple sketch. First, we define some constants that will make reading the rest of the sketch easier. The number of LEDs in the strip, the data pin on the Pro Mini that is connected to the LED strip, and the RGB color order of the LEDs. We define an array called LEDs to hold the LED strip data, and then set up the strip by telling the library that we have a strip of WS2812B LEDs connected to data pin 4, and that the data for the strip is held in an array called LEDs. Displaying colours on the LED strip is a two-stage process. First, we set the values in the LED array and then tell the library to display the data on the LED strip. So in this case, we set the first LED to green, the second to blue, and the third to red, and then tell the library to show the colours on the LED strip. If the LEDs display the wrong colours, then we should go back and change the colour order constant. Now let's have a look at a sketch that fills the LEDs with a rainbow effect. Once again, we define the constants, define the LED array, and add the LED strip. In the main body of the sketch, we have the fill rainbow command, which fills the LED strip with a rainbow of colours, starting with an initial colour hue. That command is surrounded by 2 for loops. The first increments the time delay between each iteration, and the second increments the initial starting hue. And this is the effect. In the next episode of the project, I'll be adding a microwave sensor and interfacing it to the Pro Mini. All of the parts and links that I've mentioned will be listed in the video description. If you found the video interesting, please like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you again next time.